The first deep view was taken by JWST's near-infrared camera, NIRCam, and is a composite from images obtained at different wavelengths, totaling 12.5 hours of exposure time. But that was all way back in July. What has changed since then? Well, NASA researchers have found a new galaxy that could send ripples through the scientific community. But what is this galaxy, and why are we only seeing it now? Let's find out. When we look at large areas in the sky at different redshift ranges, we see that galaxies are found distributed in a particular way in terms of intrinsic brightness. This is called the galaxy luminosity function, GLF. In very general terms, the number of galaxies decreases as the brightness increases, thus implying that there are much more intrinsically faint galaxies than bright ones. Below, there's an example of GLFs for high redshift. However, it's important to keep in mind that the more distant a galaxy is, the fainter it will appear, and telescopes have a limit on how faint an object they can see for a given exposure time. Now, one advantage of taking images with long exposure times is to collect more photons, thus making very faint objects to become visible. Thus, it's quite likely that at some time, JWST will be doing an even deeper field to explore the faint end of the GLF at very high redshifts. Both the Hubble Space Telescope, which had previously observed the galaxy but was unable to resolve the globular cluster surrounding it, and a natural phenomenon known as gravitational lensing, contributed to JWST's ability to observe the sparkler galaxy. A galaxy in JWST's first deep field image contains a galaxy 9 billion light years away, nicknamed the Sparkler Galaxy. Compared to some others in the field, that's not particularly distant. However, the sparklers that inspired the name are star clusters, at least some of which are the most distant global clusters ever seen. Globulars are dense star collections. What's more, these stars are generally really quite old and relatively pristine. They have fewer of the heavier chemical elements that taint more modern stars such as our Sun. Our Milky Way galaxy, in which our Sun lives, has more than 100 of these compact groupings littered around itself. But when and how they formed is still something of a puzzle. A good-sized cluster will have 100,000 to 1 million stars, whereas a galaxy such as the Milky Way would have 300 billion. The cluster generally contains old stars. Since you see no emission nebula generating new stars, and the clusters are generally not in the galactic plane, but form a sort of spherical halo around the galaxy. The galaxy's sparkles were quickly identified as clusters of stars, but even with JWST's mighty resolving power, the distance made it hard to identify the cluster type. On first inspection, these might be open clusters of actively forming stars, not globulars. Researchers chose 12 of these clusters uncontaminated by nearby objects to examine in depth. The absence of oxygen emission lines led them to conclude at least 5 of these are globulars, possibly the oldest we have ever found. Studying the Sparkler Galaxy's clusters is a little like seeing a photo of someone 50 years ago, allowing a more accurate estimate of their current age. The Sparkler clusters could also settle a long-running debate about how globular clusters form. Powerful as the JWST is, most globular clusters at such a distance will be beyond its capacity. However, the Sparkler Galaxy lies behind the SMAX 0723 Galaxy Cluster, which creates an extreme gravitational lens, not only magnifying the cluster's 10 to 100 fold, but creating 3 images of the sparkler. This allows astronomers to compare the images and confirm clusters are associated, rather than being in the same direction but at a different distance. The researchers also hope to use JWST to further examine distant globular clusters to get a better idea of how these objects form in general. Currently, there are 2 channels that are favored. The first is that these clusters formed at what is known as the cosmic dawn, when the universe was just beginning to assemble stars and early galaxies. Or, as the second route suggests, did globular clusters form predominantly at the cosmic noon, when most of the stars and galaxies formed? Dr. Lamaya Molaram, Toronto's Dunlap Institute for Astronomy and Astrophysics, explained, "We're finding these globular clusters to be very massive. We also find them to be very old. They could have formed in a burst at what we call cosmic noon at the peak of star formation at about 10 billion years ago. But their color isn't right. For something to be relatively young, it has to be bluer. And what we're finding is that they're much redder than we expected them to be, which means they're much older, even at that very early time. If globular clusters are really old like we think they are, then the answer would be that most globular clusters were formed at dawn and not at noon. In order to answer the questions more definitively, however, the team hopes to take a second look at the Sparkler galaxy to collect a more detailed spectrum. Gravitational lensing is the key factor that will help scientists understand the spectrum better. General relativity says the object of great mass curved the fabric of space-time. Think of this as akin to placing balls of increasing mass on a stretched rubber sheet. The larger the mass, the greater the dent, or curvature, it causes. In space, this curvature bends the path of light. When a mass of a foreground lensing object is extreme, this can make a background object, the source of this light, appear much larger or in multiple places in an image. Gravitational lensing is what gives the Sparkler galaxy its weird stretched shape. It magnifies it enough for JWST to spot it. The phenomenon also makes several of the surrounding clusters appear at multiple points in the JWST deep field image. And, perhaps most importantly, NASA will want to use JWST to look at five other gravitational lens fields to see if any more Sparkler-like galaxies with global clusters can be spotted. That's going to be like five times the amount of data we have right now, and essentially expand our data set beyond just this one galaxy. The discovery of such distant global clusters in the first deep field image from JWST is an example of how the telescope is continuing to deliver impressive findings and, in the process, shaping astronomy's future, they said. The duo are referring to the fact that while the Sparkler galaxy and its global companions are distant enough to be seen when the universe was only about 4 billion years old, this is still comparatively close considering that the JWST was designed to see galaxies as they were just hundreds of million years after the Big Bang. As Maula puts it, we are getting data that is deeper than we anticipated, which is quite surprising in the most beautiful way.